Good morning, church family. We have a couple of announcements as we get started this morning. First off, letting everyone know that next Sunday after worship, there will be a fellowship hour downstairs after worship with some cake and coffee. The cake is being sponsored by a couple of special guests who will be here in worship next week. We have a couple of former members who were married here 50 years ago this month, returning to renew their vows in the place where it all started. So I'm sure that all of you will make them feel welcome, or for those of you with very long memories, will make them feel welcome back when you see them next week. So make sure to save some room for snacks downstairs after worship next week. And one other announcement this morning, this time on behalf of our craft fair team. This year for our craft fair in November, we're bringing back a part of the Basket Social that predates my time with you, but that many of you will remember, which is our wall of board of gift cards from various local businesses. And that is your job to bring together by recruiting local businesses in the area to donate gift cards or some other sort of gift to the church. To do that, there is a sign-up sheet on the lighted bulletin board with a list of many, many local businesses to get your mind started that you can sign up for. There are also plenty of blank spaces, so if you can think of a business you think might want to donate who's not on the list, you can add your own and sign up for it. We do ask you to sign up if you're planning to ask a business so that we don't get, say, 10 people all asking Weiss to donate a gift card. That probably won't make them happy. And then there are in the parlor, yes, Pat, in the parlor, there are the two forms that you need for that, one for the businesses and one for our own records. So once you sign up, make sure you get the forms you need from the parlor. If you have any further questions about this, please ask Pat, because she is our organizer extraordinaire for this, and she has done it in the past with all of you. I am the newbie in this situation. We'll muddle through together, friends. Don't worry. Okay, and I think those were the only two announcements that I had this morning. Any other news or announcements for the community? All right. Then we will let the chimes bring us into worship. God welcomes everyone.
So everyone is welcome here.
And so I invite everyone to rise as you're able, and we will join together in this morning's call to worship. The empty tomb of Easter morning brought a changed world. A new covenant for God's people brought new commands.
Dear commands focus on loving people instead of land.
And the deeper commands showed the true heart of the old ones.
Showed the heart of God, our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer.
And we'll sing our praise with our opening hymn. We will sing all the verses of number 74. It is part of our triumphant Easter affirmation that love has won out over hatred and that life has won out over death. We do not always live as people who know that God is love. We do not always love as God has called us to love. And so we pray. Oh God, you are love incarnate. Every word you speak is love. Your every action is love. We allow ourselves to think first and foremost about the ways others might hurt us. We know we can do better. We know we can think first and foremost of the ways others might help us. Forgive us and help us be better. Moment also now for the prayers of our own hearts in the silence. Jesus Christ's every moment on this earth was about teaching us to be better. God is still speaking, still teaching us to be better. God will keep teaching us no matter how often we fail to learn. And so we proclaim. Thank you, choir. Friends, let's pray as we prepare to read our scriptures. Christ, our teacher, we have so much to learn from your words. We have so much to learn from your example. Both of these we seek in our scriptures this morning, hoping that through them we may continue to learn from your still speaking spirit. When people say,
Amen.
As we continue our Easter readings from the letter of 1 Peter, the author expands upon their theme of how Christians should act, even and perhaps especially when things are difficult. In this passage, the author writes about how they can, by their persistent faith in Jesus, put those who would persecute them for it to shame. We read from chapter 3, beginning at verse 13. Now who will harm you if you are eager to do what is good? But even if you do suffer for doing what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear what they fear, and do not be intimidated. But in your hearts, sanctify Christ as Lord. Always be ready to make your defense to anyone who demands from you an accounting for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect. Maintain a good conscience so that when you are maligned, those who abuse you for your good conduct in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if suffering should be God's will, than to suffer for doing evil. For Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. Here ends the first reading. Our gospel reading picks up a couple of verses following where we left off last week, continuing that lengthy farewell speech Jesus gives to the disciples during the Last Supper, recording the final lessons he will give them before his death. This portion of it contains a request and the promise of the help the disciples will need to fulfill it. We read from John chapter 14, beginning at verse 15. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him because he abides with you and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. Here ends the readings for today. May they be a lamp for our feet
and a light for our path.
This morning for Mother's Day, we have a special litany to say together responsibly, a prayer that acknowledges both the joy of this day for many and the ways in which this is a difficult day for some. Pray with me, church family. Loving and nurturing God, we thank you for mothers, for all they mean or have meant to us. We thank you for the wonder of your mothering. As a mother protects her children, you watch over us day by day. Loving God, we pray for those for whom Mother's Day brings heartache rather than celebration. We pray for those who have never known their mother, for those whose mothers have passed on. We wait with those who long to be mothers, but as yet have not had their own children. We grieve with those who ache because they will never be mothers. We pray for those mothers struggling with strained relationships with their children, and for those children growing and grown who struggle with strained relationships with their mothers. May all of us have the comfort of knowing that your mothering love, O God, is constant, that your understanding is perfect, and your compassion is never ending. Today our country celebrates mothers, we as people of faith know that all women are important to someone, and so we celebrate all the women of our church family with a small gift, which I have recruited a couple of gentlemen to pass out to all of our ladies. Gentlemen, you'll pass out our gifts. And now, friends, our sermon hymn is a special hymn, which is an insert in your bulletins, also specially chosen for this day. So you can join together in the first and last verses of our sermon hymn, the insert in your bulletins. Thank you. Jesus knows what's coming. He knows that this is his last chance to talk, to really talk to his friends, his disciples, before he gets arrested, before he dies. He knows that this is his last chance to tell them about what to expect for after he is resurrected, to tell them how to live in the new world he is bringing in. That's what this goodbye speech, this farewell discourse we began reading from last week is all about. But Jesus knows he'll see the disciples again. There'll be a few visits after he rises and before he ascends. But it'll be different then. They'll be too much in awe at what has happened, too busy trying to process the fact that it really is still him to take in much else. Now, if Jesus has anything he really wants them to hear and remember, now is the time. Now is the time to get them ready for the new world, the world of the new covenant, the Easter world, in which they and all of their descendants will live. And what he tells the disciples is not so surprising, really. If you love me, you'll do the things I have been telling you to do all along. And if you actually do these things I have been telling you to do all along, well, then I'll make sure you have a helper, an advocate, guiding you on the path. If you love me, then you and I will always have a relationship. As long as I live, you also will live. That's forever, by the way. You will be in me, and I will be in you. And because I am already part of God, that means God will be in you too, and you in God. I don't force this relationship on everyone, so there'll be those who don't find me and don't want to hear the advocate I'm sending. That's okay. But for those who want it, even though I won't be here physically, if you love me and if you do what I've been telling you to do, you will always be able to find me. Seems like a simple enough lesson that Jesus is teaching here. As if all he were doing was, say, teaching someone how to make a sandwich. Only a few basic steps, right? Get some bread, spread some peanut butter, spread some jelly, put them together. Except that what for Jesus is a simple lesson doesn't always feel so simple to us. It's more like he was trying to teach someone to make a sandwich, but they've never opened a jelly jar, or seen peanut butter, or even heard of a sandwich. If this is the moment where Jesus is giving us the blueprint for how to live in the new world, the Easter world, we We want details. We want to know how to love Jesus, how to follow his commandments, how to be sure if what we are hearing inside us is the Holy Spirit, our advocate, or just our own voices talking to ourselves. Our instructions for the new world, especially in this speech, are more of a basic blueprint than an in-depth manual. There's a lot of possible reasons for that. It could be the author's choice to only keep the broad strokes of the conversation, or the way the tradition of it was handed down, or some complicated combination of those. If there was more to this last conversation with the disciples, we don't have a recording of it. And besides all this, our version of the new world is wildly different from the one those first disciples faced. We do, however, have some helpful tips in the scripture. There are clues that guide us in figuring out those hows that fill in some details of the blueprint. The setting in which this snippet of chapter 14 takes place is important. We've established that it's important that this conversation is happening during the Last Supper, that it's part of the goodbye speech, that Jesus knows it is the eve of his death as he gives these instructions for the new world. But John's actual narrative is important too. I mentioned last week that a chapter before this long farewell speech begins with Jesus washing the feet of his disciples. "If I, your teacher and master," he says, "have washed your feet, you should wash each other's feet. I have set an example that you should do what I have done to you." And after this, he predicts Judas' betrayal and Peter's denial, two of the very people whose feet he just washed. He tells the disciples about the new way to follow him, saying, "I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another." This new commandment is the last one he gives them before today's passage, before the simplified steps to living in the new world. This is what is fresh in the disciples' minds when Jesus tells them that if they love him, they will keep his commandments. And after today's passage, Jesus keeps talking for about 2 to 3 more chapters. He reinforces the fact that they will be in him, and he in them, with the metaphor of the vine and the branches. God is the vine grower, Jesus is the vine, and the disciples are the branches. The branches cannot bear fruit without the vine, so the disciples must continue to be part of Jesus if they want to flourish. And then again, Jesus says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you." He warns the disciples that the world might hate them, but they should keep testifying to him and his message. Jesus tells them not to worry, because their sorrow will eventually turn to joy complete in him. And he wishes them to know peace, because he has already conquered the world. Last of all, in his long farewell speech, Jesus prays for the disciples that they and all those who come after them may be one. Jesus' simple core lesson at the center of all of this, to love him and keep his commandments, is tied to all the other parts of the speech. When we think of how to love Jesus, we are to think of Jesus washing the feet of the disciples and asking them to do the same for each other. We are to think of him asking the disciples to testify in spite of the world's hatred. We love Jesus by washing each other's feet, by tending to each other's needs, even when it means doing something that might make you feel a little uncomfortable. It might make you a little uncomfortable to speak out in defense of someone you see being wronged. But when you do it, you serve the needs of another. You wash their feet. And it might be hard to testify to God's kindness and mercy and justice in a world where all of those seem in short supply. Yet we love Jesus by standing up for his ideals, even when it seems like the world is not listening to us at all. We testify in spite of the world. And when we think of how to keep Jesus' commandments, we are to think of that last overarching command to the disciples, the one that was fresh on their minds. "I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another." And again, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you." We are to think of Jesus praying for the disciples, praying that they and those who come after them may all be one. Though there are certainly rough days, it is easy enough to love the others in this room, worshiping together with you, But Jesus' love was not limited to those in the room, not limited to his disciples. It extended to tax collectors and prostitutes, to lepers and sinners, to the temple leaders, and to the Roman centurions who hung him on a cross. When we keep Jesus' commandments, we do not only love those who fit nicely into our room, into our world. We love those who worship God differently than we do, who name God differently than we do. We love those who don't acknowledge God at all. When we keep Jesus' commandments, we remember that the divisions our world insists on between nation, race, gender, sexuality, socioeconomic class, and on and on and on I could go. We remember that those divisions do not reflect the true humanity that connects us all as children of God. We remember Jesus' prayer that they may all be one. And of course, there are more ways to love Jesus and to keep his commandments than I've just said. We only have so many minutes in sermon. And those ways are different for all of us. There are details that we each have to fill in based on our own ways of living out our faith. But this simple lesson at the core of the goodbye speech does give us a basis, a blueprint upon which we can build for figuring out our hows in this still new world. Love Jesus by serving each other's needs and testifying to him. You'll have a new chance to serve someone and a new opportunity to witness to Christ every day. Keep Jesus' commandments by loving all people and upholding their oneness. You'll have another person to welcome into God's family and to affirm in their worthiness every day. And all the rest, your own particular house, those details that fill in the blueprint, you'll figure them out as you go along through your living and your learning. As has been promised, Jesus will be right there with you while you do it. Amen. Friends, as we prepare to pray together, one piece of sad news to share this week, which many of you are already aware, Willard Culp passed away earlier this week. We celebrated his life here yesterday morning, and we thank Willard's family for the beautiful flower arrangements that they donated. We We have a sympathy card for Willard's family on the podium in the narthex, so if you did not get a chance to sign it on your way in, please do sign it on your way out. And we keep all of Willard's extended family and his many friends in our prayers at this time. And are there any other joys, concerns, prayer requests to share with the community this morning? Then let's pray, church family. Christ, our example and our instructor, we are grateful both for what you taught and how you lived, that you both laid out a blueprint for us and allow us to grow into it through our own experiences. As we continue to explore what your instructions mean for us, we lift to you these prayers for others who are also caught up in the muddle of this ever new, ever changing world. For the ones who are wondering when the violence will end, when there'll be a day without warfare or domestic violence or mass shootings, we ask you to send hope in your peace that passes all understanding. For the ones who are working for a more equitable system in their community, in their nation, across the globe, we ask you to send courage in your justice, which shall flow forth like a mighty river. For the ones who are mourning the loss of a loved one, of an opportunity, of a relationship, we ask you to send your comfort that tenderly wipes every tear. For the ones who are healing from surgery, from sickness, from spiritual stress, we ask you to send your strength, which lifts the fainting as though on eagle's wings. And finally, O Savior of the Easter world, for the ones who are figuring out your instructions for how to live, we ask you to send your advocate, that spirit which still speaks to us daily, even as you once spoke to us the words we should always pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we listen to our offertory, I invite you to meditate on how you will fill in the details of your blueprint. Thank you. our willingness to carry out your instructions for this ever new Easter blessed world. May they carry you within them wherever they go. Amen. We will sing the first three verses of our closing hymn, number 355. Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, go with you.